moves around the service to make it look like
more. Shouldn't ask me why I did that.
Afternoons. Are we almost all here? I think
we're
all right, we're two or three or five or six or eight are gathered. That's good. And of course, welcome to those who are joining us via live stream. I'm glad that you're able to be with us today. So everything that you need to worship is found in your worship bulletin, except for the hymns. There's only two, and then the blue hymnal, but we'll get through that. So I would invite, as you're able, to please stand for the opening hymn.
Thank you.
I am a resurrection and I am life, says the Lord. Whoever has faith in me shall have life, even though he die. And everyone who has life and has committed himself to me in faith shall not die forever. As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives, and that at the last he will stand upon the earth. After my awakening, he will raise me up, and in my body I shall see God. I myself shall see, and my eyes behold him who is my friend and not a stranger. For none of us has life in himself, and none becomes his own master when he dies. For if we have life, we are alive in the Lord, and if we die in the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's possession. Happy from now on are those who die in the Lord. So it is, says the Spirit, for they rest from their labors. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our sister ELSIE. We thank you for giving her to us, her family and friends, to know and to love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until, by your call, we are reunited with those who have gone before through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. The first lesson is from the book of Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. The word of the Lord. Let us say together Psalm 23 of the King James Version. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Our second reading is from 1 John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. The word of the Lord. I invite you to please stand as you are able. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Very truly, I tell you, anyone who hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and does not come under judgment, but is passed from death to life. Very truly, I tell you, the hour is coming and is now here when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God and those who hear will live. For just as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son also to have life in himself. And he has given him authority to execute judgment because he is the Son of Man. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise
Hello, everyone. Thank you all for being here, both in person, virtually today, to celebrate ELSIE's life. I'm Amy. I am the youngest of ELSIE's nieces and nephews. Today, we share in honoring ELSIE's remarkable life. I'd like to start by saying that ELSIE was a lifelong member at the Cathedral of St. John in Albuquerque, New Mexico. She became familiar with St. Thomas in 1964, where she stood as godmother to my brother Steve's, For our dear Aunt ELSIE, who lived to see her 101st birthday this past January, there is much to be said about her life and achievements. Born in 1923, she came into this world with a roar and lived through many indelible historic events. She shared many stories about her childhood, remembering as a young girl tuning into FDR's fireside chats on the radio with family. She talked about the invention of television and how it was considered a luxury to own one in the 1940s. And although motor cars had come into existence before she was born, ELSIE remembered the milkman still delivering milk to her house via horse and carriage. Of course, too, she remembered the Great Depression and shared stories of learning to sew, make, and repair her own clothes at that time. My mother often talked about ELSIE's talent for sewing and fashion. Mom admired her style, and ELSIE always looked so sharp. ELSIE remembered, too, rationing food during World War II. She was stoic and didn't speak often about the heartbreak and devastation of losing her father to ALS shortly thereafter. And later on in life, losing her eldest brother Eugene and youngest sister Lucy to the same disease. Having been born into a family of 10 children, 5 sisters and 4 brothers, ELSIE reminisced most often about the good times she shared with her siblings, as she was born and raised in Williamsport and then Cleveland, back to Williamsport, and then later in Germantown, Philadelphia. Whether it was assisting her mother with her younger siblings, or helping her grandmother in her garden, or picking wildflowers in the field, or telling stories of how she occasionally treated my mom and herself to an ice cream float on the way home from school, or that her father absolutely forbade her to wear lipstick, ELSIE always lit up when speaking about her childhood and young adulthood. In later years, she would speak daily on the phone with her sisters, Jean and Rosemary, and brother Richard, all of whom she remained very close to. She especially loved to tell stories about her baby brother Richard and her baby sister Rosemary, and still referred to them as her baby siblings while in their late 80s and 90s, which often evokes some sisterly bickering. As I remember back to my time with Aunt ELSIE as a child, it was the fun family reunions at my Aunt Jean and Uncle Bob's property in Benton, PA, where I had my first memory of her as a child. It was the occasion when ELSIE and Elton traveled from New Mexico to Pennsylvania. It was a fun time to see all the aunts and uncles reunited and having laughs together. The adults, aunts, uncles, and cousins, older cousins, would share stories while enjoying kegs of beer. And the kids would enjoy birch beer from a keg as we swam in the pond, played games, and caught frogs. In my late teens, I traveled to Albuquerque to visit with Aunt ELSIE, who cherished the memorable time we spent together, traveling to Santa Fe and then Madrid, and back to Albuquerque as we passed through several artist colonies and Indian reservations along the way. It was my first time traveling to the Southwest, and she and Uncle Elton were wonderful hosts as they introduced me to their many friends, new landscapes, Southwestern art, and food. It was clear Aunt ELSIE built a life rich in love, laughter, and adventure in New Mexico, and I truly admired her. Aunt ELSIE loved New Mexico, and she considered Albuquerque her home. Not a surprise, since the land of enchantment fits her personality. It was her bravery and courage as a young woman in her late 20s that led her and my grandmother to drive out to Albuquerque, lipstick in her purse, I'm sure, where she started work at Sandia National Labs. Admirable, because I don't think this is something that a lot of women of her generation would have even considered doing at the time. She not only built a fulfilling career for herself there, but she also met her husband, Elton, there. After marrying Eldon, she continued with her career at Sandia National Labs while she proudly managed the household, from cooking to finances, to a visit from her stepsons, Michael and Patrick, to hosting her family back east. She and Eldon enjoyed monthly dancing at the Officers Club. They also loved traveling to Colorado, where they would camp. And they periodically traveled to Las Vegas, where they loved to gamble at the casinos. Sadly, ELSIE lost Eldon a few years after retiring, and a short time thereafter, ELSIE decided to sell her home and move back east to Virginia so she could be closer to family. After a few years of living in Mineral, Virginia, near my Aunt Lucy and Aunt Jean, she decided to move back again to Albuquerque at age 81. Mom thought she was crazy to go through that again, but she understood that ELSIE missed the climate, the sunshine, the balloon festivals, the Sandia Mountains, and the Santa Fe Opera, and the Mexican food, and enjoying a margarita at happy hour with her friends. Fortunately for our family, she would come back east at Christmas time to visit my mom and spend a week or two with us each year since the time my father had passed away. We enjoyed this Christmas tradition for nearly 20 years. In August of 2018, at the age of 95, Aunt ELSIE decided once again to return east so she could be closer to family and ask my mother if we could help her move back. It was quite a task for ELSIE, Steve, and me to get her packed up on a plane to her new home at Freedom Village Retirement Community. For ELSIE, it was her deteriorating vision and hearing that made it tough, and she was frustrated with her limitations. For Steve, it was that ELSIE still wanted the weeds in her backyard pulled before leaving for the airport. And for me, it was carefully disposing of at least 100 cleaned out, single-use plastic containers, once containing applesauce, without ELSIE noticing they were gone. The last 5.5 years were a blessing for all of our families to enjoy time with ELSIE in her final time here on Earth. She was surrounded with a lot of love and support from family, time together with her sister Rosemary, my family, Lauren and Derek, visits with her brother Richard and his wife Gwen, gatherings with my brother Jim and Jackie and their children, Rachel and Ethan, nephew Chris and his wife Gina and their children, visits from nieces Emily, Cindy, Carol, and Susan, many phone calls with cousins from far away, and regular calls with her stepson Michael and his wife Terry. She enjoyed occasional parties, celebrating birthdays, meeting the significant others of her many great nieces and nephews, and regularly calling them all by the same name. She loved our dinners together on the patio, holiday gatherings, cookouts, and hundreds of car rides home, chauffeured by the one and only Steve. This was bonus time and a blessing for all of us to treasure more time and memories together with this remarkable woman, the cool aunt, as my sister-in-law Jackie would refer to her as. I would specifically like to thank my husband, Steve, who went above and beyond. In the last 6 years, to make things especially better for her and infinitely better for me. The last year it's been tough with the loss of two remarkable women, my mother last May and now ELSIE. The last of the Brown sisters, who are all now reunited in heaven, safely home and looking as beautiful as ever. And I'm sure ELSIE was welcomed with a roaring reception line, wearing her bright lipstick. We all love you, Aunt ELSIE, and miss you dearly, and thank you for the wonderful memories.
Thank you, Amy. Speak to you in the name of our loving, liberating, and life-giving God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. On behalf of the people and the clergy of St. Thomas Episcopal Church, I want to extend a warm welcome and our genuine condolences at the loss of your beloved aunt, sister, family member, and just remarkable human being. I didn't have the privilege of getting to know ELSIE myself. I've only gotten to know, really, Amy and Steve just a little bit since the death of your mom, Rosemary, last May. But in the short time that I've come to know you and to learn a little bit about these two sisters, I've been struck by the same thing, that you've described them as women who were uniquely and beautifully themselves. The kind of people who seem to radiate an inner strength and a beauty that you just can't help but notice. The word that came to my mind was vibrancy, vibrant women. There are some people who just seem to live life to the fullest, and as I've listened, Amy, to you share some stories, both about your mom and now about ELSIE, a vibrant picture formed in my mind of this uniquely beautiful person. It is no small thing to have the courage to pick up and travel across our great nation in the 1950s, no less, right? As a woman pursuing a career in science at a time when women were not encouraged to do so. And then to pursue that career in the desert of southwestern America. Extraordinary. It makes sense to me that you've described ELSIE as being an independent woman who knew her own mind up until the last days of her death. A woman who loved to travel even after the passing of her beloved husband. And also that ELSIE was this lifelong and faithful member of her church. As I was sharing with Amy and Steve, actually, it's a small world in the Episcopal Church. My father lived in Albuquerque, and we think it's possible they were in the same neighborhood, Rio Grande, a suburb, just where he could, you know, see the beautiful San Andrea mountain range. He sadly died 4 years ago, but attended the cathedral faithfully. So it's very likely, in fact, that ELSIE and my dad knew each other. So I had many opportunities to visit New Mexico, and I was surprised by the number of East Coast transplants who fell in love with the beauty of the Southwest, with these mountains that tower over plateaus, that tower over desert landscapes that are, in fact, surprisingly lush with life if you know where to look. The desert has a beauty that is uniquely its own, which seems to perfectly fit ELSIE, who seems to me that she did things in her own beautiful way, all the way into her 101st year of life. So I was, like you, kind of curious to think about the span of this remarkable lifetime. So I looked up the year of 1923, and it was so interesting to read some of the historical, you know, and interesting events of that time. That was when the Hollywood sign was first put up and inaugurated. The first electric shaver was invented the year she was born. Frozen food was invented, wasn't a thing before then. The Model T was still the most popular vehicle in America. Prohibition was still in full swing, and the number one song sweeping the nation was something called "Yes, We Have No Bananas," which my husband and children thought was hilarious. He's been singing it now for days. Over the course of ELSIE's lifetime, Amelia Earhart crossed the Atlantic, another independent woman. The Great Depression unfolded, two world wars happened, a man walked on the moon, the Berlin Wall was built and then tore down, computers were built, a thing called the internet was created, telephones became so important to daily life, and that thing that we now call a cell phone, that nearly 85% of the world now has one. A lot can change when you live as long as ELSIE did. But the hope that we proclaim as Christians is that her life has not yet ended. It is, and it will not end. It is why we name this gathering a celebration of life. It's not just the life that she had, that uniquely beautiful and God-given spark that made her who she was and is, but in fact, it's the life that continues on as ELSIE continues to grow into the fullness of her being in the light and love of God, because her life has not ended. She is in a place of perfect light
peace and love with her husband, with her siblings, with every person that she has ever loved, where with them and all the saints, she is who she was always meant to be, one who dwells eternally in the light and love of God. And so at the end of our service, in just a few minutes, we're going to go outside together to place her ashes in our beautiful memorial garden next to her sister, which it's a beautiful spot. It's right under a magnolia tree right beside it that has just begun to bloom. But because you told me that Elsie loved the desert so much, as it happened, I have a collection of desert rocks in my church office. So the last time that we went to New Mexico, it's my tradition to gather little rocks, different places that I travel, and I have four children. So they all wanted a bag to collect their own rocks too. So you can imagine how many rocks and how much dirt we came back with from that trip. So with your blessing, when we lay Elsie to rest, I thought it'd be neat to give her a piece of the desert as well. This is right from the San Andreas mountain range outside of Albuquerque, so that she can have a place of home with her. My hope for all of you is that as you gather today to share memories, to tell all the stories, to delight in laughter, and to comfort one another in your tears, that you will also rejoice in the shore and the certain knowledge that your beloved Elsie's life has not ended. It has simply changed, and that she has been reunited, not just with the ones that she loves, but with divine love itself. Amen. I invite you to please stand as you are able. Turning to page 6 in our worship bulletin, let us say together the Lord's Prayer. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. For our sister Elsie, let us pray to our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, I am resurrection and I am life. Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Elsie, and dry the tears of those who weep. Hear us, Lord. You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow. Hear us, Lord. You raised the dead to life. Give to our sister eternal life. Hear us, Lord. You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our sister to the joys of heaven. Hear us, Lord. Our sister was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give her fellowship with all your saints. Hear us, Lord. She was nourished with your body and blood. Grant her a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom. Hear us, Lord. Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our sister. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope. Father of all, we pray to you for Elsie and for all those whom we love but see no longer. Grant to them eternal rest, that light perpetual shine upon them. May her soul and the souls of all the departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more. Neither sighing, but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator of maker of mankind. We are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, You are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Elsie. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. And may the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit remain with you now and always. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Alleluia. Alleluia.